for coming to our Equality Forum. This has been an event that we've been wanting to do for a while, and a lot is on the line upcoming election. So this is going to be a critical event for us to learn more about our candidates. All right. To learn more about our candidates who are behind us right here. And I want to introduce Ms. Lauren, who's going to be our moderator tonight. So if everyone help me, Ms. Lauren.
I'm in the second hour.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lauren Ferris. I'm with the Transgender Education Network of Texas. And I want to recognize, before we get started, I want to recognize just a few people. Some of you may have been to Austin, either the 6th or the 20th. There's a dynamite coalition that people probably never thought could work together, but we've worked together to produce just two amazingly incredible lobby days. And that is the Texas Freedom Network, Ray Martinez, the Human Rights Campaign, Isaac Garcia, Equality Texas, Pierre Cuellar, and Robert Salcido. And there's, I don't think there's anyone here from ACLU. And the Transgender Education Network of Texas, if you look at, stand up, Bailey, and Alice, they have on t-shirts that have the five emblems on the back. And I introduce those people to begin because we have a long way to go. But there's an amazing, amazing group of people here tonight. And I want to recognize just a few. Drew Galloway from Move San Antonio. James Poindexter from Pride San Antonio. Ashley Smith from 35th Indivisible. And a couple of trans people, because we are real, we do participate, and we do vote. Emmett is the new president of the San Antonio General Association. Eric Macias is in the back. He's with the Trans Men of San Antonio. And I think I've met most of the organizations that are not asking questions. We will be introducing other people to ask questions from some other organizations as well. So, without further ado, Keith, Tony, let me tell you the format first. Our format is, for the first hour, we will be asking questions of districts 2 through 10, the candidates that are here. We thought we would have 7, we have 5. And we will begin with 2 minutes for them to introduce themselves. Then different organizations will be asking questions, and they will have 1 minute each to respond. We will try to keep it very equal in time, and I'm bashful about cutting people off if we need to. 1 person that I forgot, I don't think either of the co-chairs are here, but the former co-chair is sitting right here. I'd like to introduce you to Carol Lee Moore, who's the former co-chair of Stonewall Democrats in San Antonio. That seemed important because, as we know, all of the individuals sitting up here are nonpartisan, of course. But I want to introduce who we have up on the list of you. Keith Tony from District 2 has signed up to be here. He is not. Jessica Guerrero from District 3. Melissa Cabello Haverda from District 6. She is here. Rick Treviño from District 6 also. Ana Sandoval from District 7 had signed up, but she is not here. Tony Valdivia.
Valdivia, yes. Thank you.
From District 8. And finally, John Alvarez from District 10. So we're going to give you each 2 minutes to introduce yourselves. This is, I don't know if you've noticed, because we look like everyone else, but we are the LGBTQ plus community. And we're here to ask you about that. Because although you may not have a cool strip like this in your district, I guarantee you that all of you are LGBTQ plus people in your districts. So, so as you introduce yourselves, it would be wonderful, it's not a requirement, but it would be wonderful if you addressed the LGBTQ community directly.
Buenas tardes, my name is Jessica Guerrero. I'm running for District 3, that's the southeast side of San Antonio. I'm really proud to be here with you today. Of course, all of this area is super familiar to me. I've been, going out on this trip for a long, long, long time. and I'm very proud of that. And although we may not have quite as cool a strip like this in D3, I think that can happen very soon. We see a lot of changes coming up in District 3 that I'm really excited about, but that a lot of my neighbors, not constituents yet, a lot of my neighbors are really concerned about, falling through the cracks of those decisions that are bringing those developments about. And I want to be sure that our voices are heard, that all of our voices are heard at City Hall when these decisions are being made on how development is organized in District 3. We want to be sure that it's a district for everyone. We want to make sure that current, long-time, and long-term residents of District 3 are heard. And that includes, absolutely, the LGBTQ community, whether they're out or not, right? People need to feel safe. People need to feel wanted. People need to feel at home in their communities. And that's what I'm hoping I can help facilitate in District 3. So, gracias for having me.
Good evening. My name is Melissa Cabello Haverda. Thank you so much for inviting me here tonight. I'm excited to be here. I'm proud to say that I grew up in District 6. I went to Taft High School out there, and there's a lot of growth out there. But when people ask me why I decided to run for District 6, I tell them a story about me and my grandfather. We were walking in his neighborhood on the street, and I noticed that there weren't any sidewalks. So I looked up at him and asked, why are we walking on the street? My grandfather was a hardworking man, a carpenter, treated people with respect. He looked down at me and said, porque no les importa, they don't care about us. That conversation with him hurt me. He was strong, he was a pillar in my life, and he didn't feel like he had a voice. It led me to practice law, where I fight for the rights of disabled, veterans, seniors, and it led me to run for District 6. In my practice, I represent the LGBT community. I know your issues directly. they are, you know, employment discrimination, lack of health care, you know, access to health care. We have homelessness, unfortunately, especially with the younger generation, and violence against them. So when you come to me in my practice and say, I've been to five other lawyers, I'll take your case because I want to be your voice. Because I want to send the message to City Hall, que si les importa, that we matter. Thank you.
Hello everybody, my name is Rick Trevino. For those who don't know me, I'm a teacher, I'm a progressive. I've been teaching for 5 years now on SAISD on the east side. And as an educator, I see every day the struggles of working people. Many people are working longer hours for lower wages. Working families are having a hard time paying their bills, thinking about how they're gonna send their kids to college. I've been speaking to so many senior citizens who should be retired, but they're forced to go back into the workforce because on Social Security alone, they're not able to make it. They have very expensive prescription drug medicine. They make tough decisions every day. And those are the people I'm primarily concerned in representing, the working families of District 6. And you can sum up my campaign in 3 points. A living wage for all people. Because I don't think it's controversial to say that if you work 40 hours a week, you shouldn't live in poverty. So a living wage in both public and private sectors. 2, I support neighborhood empowerment. We have to empower our churches, our schools, our community centers, because that's where true power lies. Not one person, not a bureaucrat, not a politician. We need to empower civic engagement. And 3, I want to bring back ethics and integrity into City Hall. Because as you guys know, I'm 32 years old and I'm sick and tired of a political system that's run by big money. And we need to move to publicly funded elections and get big money out of our local politics. And I've been very proud of my advocacy for the LGBTQ community. I was formerly the secretary of the Bexar County Democratic Party, and when I was a Democrat, we supported the NDO at City Hall. I was proud to stand by my LGBTQ brothers and sisters fighting with them. And as a teacher, I'm looking forward to the future because the millennial generation, the young generation that's coming up, they're so open and inclusive. I have trans students, gay students, and to see how they interact with their peers, their embrace, their love, they're not ostracized anymore. And the LGBTQ community, their advocacy created this possibility. From Stonewall to the advocacy of the AIDS issue in the 80s, they fought tooth and nail to be treated with respect. And that has paid dividends because I see it every day in my classrooms, in the hallways, and we have to applaud the work of the LGBTQ community for advocating for themselves and in making America realize that they're human beings and they deserve to be respected just like everybody else. Thank you.
Hi, how y'all doing today? First, I want to congratulate you all by being here and taking action and being engaged, because that's what it's about. It's about having your voice heard. You know, a lot of people ask, Tony, why are you running? But before I get there, I have a confession to make. I know a lot of you might not believe this. It's going to be very hard to understand, but the truth is, I haven't always been the super cool person you see in front of you today. As you can tell, I'm not a very big guy. So, of course, in high school, you know, a lot of us, I was the easy target to pick on and bully. And yes, I was even that kid that was thrown into a locker room. You know, yeah, it's embarrassing. But one day I stood up for myself. And in that moment, I discovered a couple things. First, I was much stronger than anybody gave me credit for. And second, that I had a voice. And I believe it is this strength that allows me to use my voice to share my message with each of you today, including the embarrassing parts about being thrown in a locker. As time went on, those same boys, they'd be like, oh man, Tony, he's a small little guy, but he's scrappy, he's not worth it. All they did was move on to the next kid. And that's when I learned my next and most valuable lesson. That it wasn't enough just for me to stand up and speak for myself, but I had to speak up for others who haven't discovered that strength in themselves. That's one of the main reasons why I'm running. It's to make sure I'm that voice for everybody that needs to be heard, to stand up for injustice, and make sure that we're all engaged and civically involved. A little bit about myself, it's also why I enjoy working for a company that serves our military veterans and their families, because that mission of service to others that have served our country speaks very highly to my own mission, which I feel is helping improve the lives of those in my community. That's why I've been involved in a lot of volunteer work, from doing shifts down in the San Antonio food bank. And before I was running, I wanted to make a difference in my city government. So in my spare time, I volunteered to serve as the special projects coordinator for District 8, where I work alongside Ryan Nuremberg and our district manager, Ray Garza. It's all about being involved, engaged. One, make sure you have a voice. I have a strong financial background, so I can bring fiscal accountability to City Hall. And third, I want to make sure that we have safe neighborhoods, that our police and fire are the best trained, best equipped, so they're there when we need them. I know you've all taken action today by being here. I'm going to encourage you to take one more action. Please go to my website, votetonyb.com. On the How to Get Involved page, I have what I call the Be the Change Challenge. I'm going to ask you just to do one of three things. One, if you like my message, donate $25. Two, help me share my message by volunteering on my campaign or sharing my website or Facebook. Or three, go out and volunteer for a nonprofit here in San Antonio, whether it's the San Antonio Food Bank or Move San Antonio. Thank you for your time.
Hello everyone, my name is John Alvarez. I'm running for City Council for District 10 up on the northeast side. I want to introduce myself for just a minute. I've been active in District 10 for a few years now. I look young, I get that a lot, and I'm glad to be in a young room. This is nice, especially coming from District 10. It's a bit of a more older, conservative district, so I'm very happy to be in this room. But I've been active working with current Councilman Mike Gallagher for the last several years. I was appointed by the previous councilman to be his representative on the SA 2020 Commission for Strengthening Family Well-Being. I was elected to represent Districts 8, 9, and 10 on the Community Action Advisory Board. In both of those positions, we were addressing the issues of homelessness, poverty, underemployment, and child abuse. And I say that because I know that those issues are near and dear to the LGBT community. And I also say that because coming from District 10, that is an area where those issues were not as near and dear. So I've been fighting for those issues in my district, and I want to bring it to the San Antonio leadership for District 10 as well. Professionally, I'm a licensed professional counselor. I work for a nonprofit agency called Communities in Schools. Our objective is to keep kids successful in schools. What I do is I'm on a special project, so I provide one-on-one therapy for some of their most at-risk youth. And as you can imagine, a lot of those children have seen abuse, have seen violence, have seen neglect, have seen trauma. And a lot of those children are facing issues with their sexual identity, with rejection from their families. Sometimes they are homeless because of those reasons. So I have seen firsthand what that can do to a student and what that can do to that student's future. So these issues are very near and dear to me. And that is part of the reason why I wanted to get in the fight, especially in District 10, where the LGBT community has not been friendly, has not had friendly representation for the past several years. For the past several years, we've sent leadership to City Hall that has been more conservative, that has been more judgmental. And we need to change that trend. And that's why I'm getting in the race, because I want support from socially progressive people who want to increase equality across San Antonio. Thank you.
Thank you all. I encourage you to remember that language matters, and you're sitting in a room full of LGBTQ people, and so a lot of the language you use is going to be scrutinized. So we're now going to begin with questions. And the first question is about you. I don't know if you are aware, but approximately 40% of the nation's homeless youth are LGBTQ+. And we make up a much smaller percentage of the general population. So Marcos Antuna is here somewhere. There he is. From Fiesta Youth. He has asked me to read their question for you. And we're going to start at this end, Ms. Robertis. We'll start with you to answer the question. Each of you will have 1 minute, and we will need to get you off so we can get more questions in. What specifically would you do to improve the lives of LGBT youth in San Antonio? What specifically?
Well, we're talking, immediately we're talking about homelessness, 40% of homelessness, but the problem does not stop there. LGBT youth are more than twice as likely to be victims of hate crimes, more than three times as likely to be homeless or incarcerated, more than four times as likely to attempt or commit suicide than the general population. And so we're talking about discrepancies, huge discrepancies across all measurements of quality of life. So it's one question, but it's a massive question. How do we address the quality of life across all different aspects? Well, for homelessness, personally, I believe there should not be homelessness in the city of San Antonio. There are solutions for homelessness. They would be in money-saving initiatives. We can save money and treat people better. We can end homelessness for veterans, for children, for the general population, and for the LGBTQ community. So I believe that we should address homelessness first. I also think that we need to make mental health is my field. I think we need to make those resources more equitable and more accessible for everyone. And so those are the two things that I would start.
Well, first I want to say thank you for the question. That's a very, very challenging question because it is a large problem. You know, I think the first thing to do is to lead by example. It's to be out in the community at events like this and be engaged with everybody. It's to rally people around getting involved with different organizations, different nonprofits here that specialize in areas around homelessness, around LGBT communities, and getting out, getting involved. So I think with that, it's just getting out there and taking action and saying, hey, we care. We're here, we listen, and putting a human face on it. I think the biggest thing out there is helping people identify on each other at the human level. And I know that that starts with creating friendships and bringing people together to communicate. So that's how I would do it, just doing my best to be a leader and show, hey, here's the way we should do it. So I'd love to talk to you more if you have a follow-up to that.
Hearing that number is shocking, and the reason why that's the reality is because a lot of LGBTQ young people are pushed out of their families. They find themselves in that situation because they don't find a friend at home. And the reality is, our older generation is more conservative, and a lot of the families just don't understand this transition. I see it firsthand. One of my best friends is transgendered. He was ostracized from his family, was not allowed to see his friends, his family, his grandmother, his grandfather. It broke her heart. And what we need to do as a city, if we really want to get serious about dealing with that, we need a city-funded LGBTQ center. Because you just can't go to anywhere. You have to understand that the issues of the LGBTQ community are unique. They need to know that when they're going to the center, that they're going to be listened to. Someone who empathizes with them. Because what happens is that if people are afraid that they're going to be judged, they don't enter that room. They need a safe space. And we also have to, and if the city is leading on that, it's a message to all of America that San Antonio is a friend to the LGBTQ community. We can be proactive, and the city needs bold funding in the LGBTQ center. And as your District 6 representative, I will make that one of my priorities. Thank you.
That's my number one answer. San Antonio needs an LGBTQ resource center. I'd love to have it in District 6, but I would advocate for it to be anywhere in our city. Not just for we need a place to go. I mean, as a community, the LGBT community needs a place to go. Not just for the homeless kids, you know, but for the rest of the community. Go in and learn about the issues, the LGBTQ issues, so you're not pushing your kids out the door. When they come in and tell you what they are, how they were born, support them. Go to the LGBTQ center and learn about it, and don't push them out. Don't ostracize them from their families. So it's not just for the children themselves or the community, but for everyone else to learn about it and to become engaged and educated. Thank you.
I think that it's really important that no matter what happens at the state or the national level, that San Antonio, from our community to City Hall and back, are absolutely committed to protecting the NDO locally.
We need to be sure that we continue that momentum, that we continue to expand the NDO, and that we really look at what it means to expand it, right? That as we're continuing to work out the budget and make sure that this new center is funded, that we also do as we have with all of our other advocacy and activism, that we make sure that LGBTQ issues are community issues, that we're learning together, right? How all of these things are intersected. Right, that children's services include LGBTQ transgender children's services, right? That the CRTs, the crisis response teams that have been constantly, you know, their budgeting has been threatened, that the group, the community, you know, people that are trained to help respond to moments of violence, that they have that training also to deal with a queer community situation, right? That is violent, that needs a certain type of attention. We need to be sure that all of this is throughout all of our communities.
So I want all of you also to remember, this is not a presidential campaign. This is a progressive group with long memories. So be careful what you say, because you will hear it again. From the San Antonio Progressive Alliance, I would like to introduce Alice Canestetto Garcia. She asked a question from that group, and if someone would give this microphone back there.
Hello, can y'all hear me? My name is Alice Canestetto Garcia, and I have a question. What steps do you plan to take as individuals and as our district representatives to encourage people who are not yet LGBTQ allies to become allies? Thank you. What's really exciting about this campaign for me is that I am challenging a very strong, very well-funded incumbent. So it is a huge challenge. It also means that it's also a reality that I come from a community serving background, right? I've been in community for a long time. So the work that I'm doing, what I'm talking about right now are things that I've been talking about, are things that I'll continue talking about, regardless of what happens in this election. And I'm especially disappointed with our current representation in District 3 and her lack of support for the NDO. We saw her really, you know, stall, wait a super long time to declare her position, and that's unacceptable to me. These issues are human, it's a human rights issue. So as we're talking to people in community and we talk about economic development and about the challenges around really aggressive development, we need to be sure that we're not just bringing in this LGBTQ issue in a way that is communicated based on economics. It's not about economics, it's a human right, it's a human dignity issue.
It's absolutely a human rights issue. It is, as an attorney, I see it as a civil rights issue. It's another protected class. However, it is also an economic issue. And I think one way to make allies, the people that are not currently allies, the people that are against us, is to make sure that they understand that these economic disparities are going to impact them too. The businesses that aren't coming here because of the proposed bathroom bill, you know, there are businesses that would probably not discriminate against the LGBT community. We need to attract them here. We need to make sure that they're going to come and offer employment, because the LGBT community needs jobs. You know, and unfortunately, employment discrimination is a real factor here in San Antonio. So again, you know, I'll refer back to my last answer too, but it's education. As an attorney also sitting on city council, I can advocate. I'll fight for you. I mean, I know that you're one of 11 votes on city council. And there are people sitting there now that would not and have not advocated for you. And that's something that I can offer as well. Thank you.
Well, the political climate in the United States of America right now is so polarized, and it's, and really what's happened at the state level is disgusting. to see a community demonized, criminalized, just for political votes. You know, it really breaks my heart to see that. And what I will do as councilperson, I'll make sure that my office has an open door policy to the LGBTQ community. And not only that, that I have a staff that is diverse. If an LGBTQ constituent comes to the door, that they know that they'll have someone there with a shared experience that they can listen to. And not only that, I want to be a public supporter of the LGBTQ community. I want to use them in my language. I'm not going to be afraid to stand with my LGBTQ brothers and sisters at any of their rallies. When they're defending themselves against bigotry, I will be there. I will march with you. I will lobby and advocate. We ask too little of our political officials. I'm tired of hearing politicians say, that's not my purview. That's ridiculous. Your elected officials are put there to advocate for you. And if there's anything that's going to have adverse effects on my constituents, on the LGBTQ community in District 6 in San Antonio, I'm going to have something to say about that. And what we also have to do is facilitate community. Because if there's only less than 50% of the voting population happening, and if people are being demonized, and they're still getting reelected, well, we have to make sure that they know that we're going to create a city of 60, 70, 80% voter turnout, and they will listen to you. And there will be political consequences for being a bigot, for being an enemy of the LGBTQ community. And what I want to do is facilitate that type of dynamic community engagement we need to force people who are not advocates to be allies. Thank you.
Another great question. This is a challenging one. Because we know that there's probably going to always be some contingent that's always going to, they're never going to come over to see the light. So with that said, one thing that I want to do is make sure to stand up for what's right and what's fair. You know, I think the Constitution is a great document, but to me, what really captures the heart of what it means to be an American is the Declaration of Independence. And in there, it says that all men are created equal. It also continues to say that we are endowed with certain unalienable rights, among these life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So if we have two people, regardless of their creed, color, national origin, sexual orientation, because they're created equal, who want to express their pursuit of happiness by declaring their love for each other, they should have the liberty to do so. And so what I plan to do is keep standing up with you and fighting for what's right and what's fair for all of us. So having the dialogue, having those conversations, and meet them with love. I know it's tough. I know it's one of those things. I know that my experience may not compare to some of your experiences here, but I know what it's like to be picked on for being different. And what we need to do is have that voice to stand up, say, hey, what you're doing is wrong, but also say, you know what? We're willing to be bigger people and overcome that and welcome you into to who we are. And hopefully you'll learn about us and accept us.
Unfortunately, the Civil Rights Act in the 1960s did not end bigotry. It did not end racism. That took years. That struggle continues today. We still have to find allies for marginalized groups. The battle for social justice will be fought on two fronts. One will be legislative. The elected leaders that we send to City Hall, to the state legislature, to Washington. The other will be social. Those active community organizers who stand up and resist and speak loudly and forcefully and say, this behavior is unacceptable. And both of those fronts must work together. Lyndon Johnson would have been nothing without Martin Luther King and his courage on the front lines of that part of the battle. Any elected leader, myself included, must stand shoulder to shoulder with the social activists to show our community that we, as elected representatives, will stand with you in both fronts of that battle to improve our equality and to gain allies in our battle for social justice.
Thank you. This panel, the first response will come from Rick Navinia, and we'll go that way and then around. I understand you're going to need to leave.
Yes.
So to ask this question is, a very young woman from Move SA, Arlene Serena.
Would eradicate local non-discrimination ordinances across Texas, including San Antonio's 2013 ordinance for public employees and contractors. If elected, what specific actions will you take to ensure LGBT persons feel welcome and are protected in our city?
I find it funny that so many conservatives preach, you know, talking about the federal government has its own, responsibilities on how to interact with the states. Well, I think the state is overreaching on what it's imposing on the city. We've seen this all across the state. And if for them to strip the city the power of the democratic decision of its citizens is outrageous. The NDO was created by the advocacy to get it there. Took so much work. We're just not going to take that away because, we have some hard-line right-wingers dictating policy up there. That's unacceptable. And again, we need a city to be bold and advocate for itself. There's been a precedent set at the state level of taking away local control. It happened in Denton. When they banned fracking, they took away that right. They've taken away the right of cities to set their own wages. That's ridiculous. Cities bigger than us and smaller than us have met the needs of their citizens' economic lives. And that is only going to further entrench our state in that type of control. And if our state is still being run by really corporatists, people who are bought and sold by the richest and most corrupt institutions in the world, well, we got to do something about that. Our cities have to fight back. And not only that, look at what's on the line. If our cities take, if they take away that right, well, guess what? People will be discriminated against. Business will turn people away. And this is 2017. And this is unacceptable. America has become more progressive. My generation is the most open, loving generation in the history of the United States and America, and I am not going to let my state dictate what my city does. We need to control ourselves, our destiny, not the state of Texas. Thank you so much.
If it was eradicated, if it was passed? Okay. So if there was no NDO, you're asking, right? Okay. I completely agree with Rick. We would do everything we could to stop that from happening. But if it did happen, what we could do, number one, is the corporate community in San Antonio is not, I've met with them a lot, just because I'm running, they're not adverse to making sure that the LGBT community is not discriminated against. So I think we have to go in just one by one. We have to talk to them. We have to educate. We have to make sure that our resource center is available to them and make sure that they're not discriminating. Private industry is malleable, especially by government. Because, city council can only do so much, but you have a platform. And there's a lot of pressure that you can put on companies to do the right thing. So I think that number one is educating and making sure that they're not discriminating. If there's not a law telling or an ordinance telling them to do so. But of course, we would try to stop it where it starts, because we wouldn't. We passed this and it was voted on by our council members who were we elected representatives, and that's where we try to stop that from happening at all. Thank you.
As city council representative, I would work with other members of city council to instruct our city attorney to find those loopholes that we very well know will exist as they do in any law and any policy, so that we can, as a city, from City Hall, right, from within City Hall, push towards more justice throughout our community. I want to be part of reclaiming City Hall, along with many other progressive candidates that are running right now, and for us to work together to, again, bring it from the inside out, bring that justice up into the community. We know that everyone throughout the community is going to continue organizing, going to continue challenging those policies, and I'll be right there with you, whether I'm at the dais on Thursday morning and, you know, with you as right before I walk in there to protest, to voice our opinion. So I think that, you know, if we can have more people from within City Hall instructing city staff, city attorneys, to look at how to overcome something like that, that's what we need. We need a majority in there.
Yeah, I agree with what the previous candidates have said. This, I can't imagine something like this, a measure going forward, without it leading to an eventual Supreme Court case. As an elected representative, I would back a Supreme Court surge against a movement like that all the way. But what at the state level, what they'd be attempting to do, and this comes back to my analogy of a two-front battle for social justice, they would be attempting to destroy the legislative part of that battle, to take out the representative part of that battle, to take away our power as elected representatives. Well, that means that it's just as important for us to promise to you up here that we will stand by you either in City Hall, if that power is taken away from us, we will join you on the streets marching with a sign, making sure that those cases end up at the Supreme Court of the United States.
Well, I think first this goes to my view of government. I do not believe government should just be a group of people who arbitrarily make decisions on how the rest of us should live. To me, government should be a platform that allows us to come together as citizens to help solve problems and help each other. So with that said, even if that law is passed and the NDO is no longer law, I would make sure that the policy for City Hall would not change, that we would stay here, that we would make that policy the same. And then on top of that, then we would fight through whatever course we need to, through the court system or for lobbying for the new legislation to come out to repeal that. Because here in San Antonio, we don't want to be a New York or a Houston or a Dallas. We want to be the very best version of San Antonio we can be. And we should have the power to decide what that is for ourselves at the city level.
So, I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to. If you identify, if you're comfortable, if you're not comfortable, just stay right where you are. But if you're comfortable and you identify as genderqueer, gender nonconforming, you identify as gender nonconforming because of expression, or you identify as trans, whatever, would you stand up if you're comfortable? If you're comfortable. We're going to be peeing in your bathrooms, regardless of what Austin does. I hope you know. And we're going to need your support and your help. And that goes for every candidate in the room. Thank you all. And now, a longtime friend from Texas A&M University San Antonio, Rene Orozco.
Hello, candidates. To stop misconceptions, education is key. What is currently being done to educate the general public about the LGBT community, and what will you do to improve that education to end stigmas and misconceptions about the LGBT community?
Well, first, what I would do is ask for your help. How can I help you educate others? Because if anybody knows anything about having to deal with these issues, it's going to be this community right here. And this is where I need to come first, is what can I do to help you? Second is, like I said before, is standing up, being the voice. I know what it's like to be bullied, and I know it's the strength that I have to stand up against it. So when people say, you know, whatever it is they want to say, I'm not going to go with that. I'm going to do what I feel is right. And that is standing up for freedom and equality and for people to have the ability to live the lives they want to live. I'm sorry, I don't have a better answer for that, but to me, it's just, I'm going to do whatever I can to lead by example. And to me, what it means to be a leader is to look to the person to the left of me, the person to the right of me, and say, you know what? I have your back. I'm going to make sure that we get through this together. So that's what I'm going to try to do.
I'm an clients who are in the LGBT community, and unfortunately some of them are HIV positive and they have a lot of trouble getting access to healthcare. They're not getting hired because they have their HIV positive, and they're being honest in an interview, which they can't even ask that. But so they come to me about discrimination issues. They come to me because they're applying for disability, because they just need Medicaid, they need help. So I think that's one thing that I would really focus on is healthcare, is access to healthcare, and make sure that we have a program where no matter the status, the HIV status, you're gonna have access to healthcare, you're gonna get treatment, you're not gonna go on disability, because now you'll be able to have healthcare and get well enough to work. So that's something that I would really point focus on.
So much from each other, right? Just in community, in the work we're doing, when we're protesting together, when we're demonstrating together. And I think that has been like a huge classroom for me and for a lot of people. I think we need to be sure that we protect our right locally to march in the streets, to organize, to freely talk about what we need to talk about, to freely be able to ask each other questions, to be able to call each other out on things, to be accountable to each other, right? And then, of course, beyond that, to have that open door to City Hall to bring all of that collective knowledge and hold our city officials accountable on and on, over and over again, right? City Hall is not accessible to people. The schedule for all of those citizens to be heard meetings, for the city council meetings, need to be changed so that more of us can get there before or after our work things and in between and with the people that we're learning from.
I think to answer your very good question, what we're doing now, this is what's affecting your question. You are educating us. If we are to be elected, this should never stop. As elected representatives, those who are in power now should be here now. They should be listening to the concerns, and they should be carrying those concerns back to City Hall and back to their districts. Representatives from this group should be at neighborhood association meetings or at district meetings. The conversation should be diverse, and we should be informing each other about all needs, not just one neighborhood association or another. It should be a very diverse conversation. Another tool I think that we haven't mentioned, but is technology. I've become much more educated just through groups that are here today, SAPA, MOVE. I've learned so many things just by social activists who are passionate and speak loudly, continue to
then their straight peers.
Would you repeat the question?
Studies at the University of Massachusetts in Washington have found that LGBTQ people are paid far less on average than their straight peers.
Again, I think everything that we've been talking about speaks to that, right? People are either uninformed about the fact that it is a human right to be who we are, however we are. And I think there's also the other thing that's happening is that people feel protected by current laws, by current policy, by current climate of political dialogue to act in discriminating ways. And the more that we continue to push those policies, to include them, to push people to come out of themselves and be in the streets and come back home and advocate, that's my feeling, to really go all the way, right, as far as we need to go, to make sure that our voices are heard, so that all of this discrimination would be that much more, it would be no longer tolerated because people would be speaking up about it, and those employers would be held accountable.
First is propose a pay equality ordinance. I think that's the easy fix, at least for the city. And then start there with the city and then try to expand out to the business community. Make sure that you use your platform really and expand that ordinance. Talk to your state representatives. I have a great relationship with our state rep, Nina Mijares. Jose Menendez is our state senator. And those are two very LGBTQ, pro-LGBT community people. So we started the city, we expanded to the state, and we worked our way out, you know, and eventually take over the man in the White House, right? But I really think that just proposing that ordinance could go a long way.
So another, difficult question. Thank you for that again. Once again, I think we could, propose a legislation here in the city to make sure that discrimination is not tolerated. And I think the other thing we can do as a city itself is make sure that we're setting a good example by making sure that same type of behavior is not happening with city employees. So I think that's really the basis of it. Let's look at what kind of legislation, make sure that we're taking care of the city employees that work for us, because my philosophy is you take care of people because people take care of the city. So let's make sure that they're all treated fairly and equitably. Beyond that, just let's make sure to keep raising those, setting those stats, and being a voice for people who still need to hear that. So thank you for calling that to all of our attentions.
I completely agree with your recommendation. If I were to be elected, I would strongly support something that I might call a responsible employment ordinance. And I think that would require all city employees, as well as any contractor that the city did business with, to make sure that those types of discrimination were not tolerated in their employment practices. So I would absolutely support that.
So there are three organizations that have not yet asked questions. We're going to get them to start the next group rather than this group, because I would like to give, we have just enough time probably to ask two quick follow-up questions from the general audience. So does anyone in the audience have a follow-up question for these candidates from anyone? Okay. David?
Question concerns the non-discrimination ordinance. The state legislature may pass legislation that says that our non-discrimination ordinance, as well as non-discrimination ordinances all over the state, are null and void. And we can roll over and play dead, or we can take some strong initiative. So my question is, you can answer this question either hell yes or hell no. My question is, if you're on the council, would you take the initiative to get the city council to direct the city manager, to direct the city attorney's office, to file in state court and federal court violations of the state constitution and the federal constitution, the 14th Amendment, equal protection of the law, and then Article 1, which in the state constitution, which is the Bill of Rights in our state, it's Article Number 1, file charges both in state and federal court to declare our right to enforce our local ordinances.
I can answer with an emphatic hell yes, and if they wouldn't do it, I could file it myself.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Hell yes.
Hell yes, and again, we need a majority of progressive candidates at City Hall. So yes.
Remember, we have long memories.
We're being recorded.
Does anyone else have one follow-up question? Any? Robert?
I guess this is more of a statement than a comment or a question. First, I commend all of y'all for being here this evening, and I commend those of you that have actually been able to say the word LGBT tonight as well. So my question or my comment is, based on the LGBT community and what we have here in San Antonio, the seven comparative cities that we have, that the city of San Antonio uses for other data and other information, currently fund LGBTQ community centers as well as LGBTQ community organizations that offer social services for community. As council individuals, what would you do to help fund or push that forward and push that needle a little bit more in the progressive direction to have our LGBT organizations funded in San Antonio?
Thank you for that question.
Sure, I think it starts with, like you were saying, have a progressive majority in City Hall. I absolutely support both the resource center and a program in order to provide resources for that LGBTQ community. And so I think that we should provide that as part of our funded city program, as part of our annual city budget, because of the statistics that we had talked about earlier, the lack of access to health care, mental health resources, increasing education across our city. So absolutely, I think that first we need to make sure that we get a progressive majority, and we need to push for that hard in legislation and city council.
Well, I think that the free of funding, first thing we have to do is look at the projects that are currently being funded and make sure we cut out the pet projects. I know there's a lot of councilmen that fight for things that don't return a real benefit. And I think a community center is something that would benefit relations and help everybody. So I think one thing we need to do is make sure we look at our spending, also how much our city manager and how much they're making, and make sure that we're able to concentrate on what we need as a city, starting with streets, fire, and protection, and then making sure we have money for social issues. So I hope that answers your question, yes?
Sort of making this phrase up, but we need to raise our LGBTQ IQ in San Antonio. I don't think we're being seen nationally as a progressive city in that way, and hopefully a majority council would change that. But you know, there's city funding, absolutely. I think that's the number one thing we should do is city fund a resource. But once we're seen, and we raise our IQ in that way, we'll be seen as a progressive city. And then we can get that national funding. We can leverage our dollars here and get national nonprofits, national foundations, and get that money here and really start to fund it. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. We need to make sure that center is funded. The other thing that we also need to do is to diversify membership, not only of city council, but of all committees, commissions, all of the groups that are doing all of the decision making at City Hall, to make sure that funds are more appropriately and wisely invested in our LGBTQ community, right, throughout the city. Because again, all of these issues, all of the pockets of funding, they're all intersected, right? They're all interrelated, and we need to be sure that we're receiving, that our communities are receiving the support we need in a holistic way, not just, you know, certain very specific services.
So we're going to bring part one to an end. Will you all stand up? Let's give them a big round of applause and thank them for being here. Remember, we have long moments. So we're going to take 10 minutes till 7:35. We're going to take a quick potty break and switch candidates, and District 1 and mayoral candidates will be on the stage when we come back in 10 minutes. Thank you. There are so many people here, and you guys did such an amazing job that some other candidates decided that they needed to be here as well. We're LGBTQ, and we vote, and they're learning that. So, Ezra Johnson from District 10 will get 3 minutes to introduce himself and to speak, but no question. And then Anna Sandoval from District 7 will also get 3 minutes to speak. And then we will move on to District 1, and we will do 30 to 35 minutes of District 1, and then the mayoral candidates separate. Okay? So, okay, please quiet down. Please keep it.
Hush! Hey! everybody. Thank you very much for allowing me some time on stage. I apologize I was not here at the beginning of the event, but very glad to be here. My name is Ana Sandoval, and I'm running for City Council in District 7. That's the community where I was raised, where I grew up, and where I live today, next door to my childhood home, next door to my parents. So I sound very traditional in that sense. I went to public schools, graduated from Thomas Jefferson High School, and thanks to that I was able to travel and go to some schools outside of San Antonio. I studied engineering on the East Coast and the West Coast. And I came back here, I worked at VIA for a couple of years. So I'm a firm believer in having a safe, reliable, and a robust public transportation system that works for all San Antonians. And after working there, I moved to San Francisco, where I lived for a number of years, working in air pollution control. And now I'm back here in San Antonio. I think my district, District 7, needs a strong voice at City Council. That's why I'm running. Could I get a sense of where folks are in the room geographically? Districts 1 through 5? Okay, 6 through 10? Seven. Well, as you know, whatever happens at the council level affects all of us. Whatever happens at the council level affects all of us. So I hope that you will see in me someone who is ready to represent all residents, all communities of San Antonio, and help us move forward. I've had the great pleasure of spending some time speaking with Mr. Robert Sancedo, who's here today, and have taken very much into consideration some of the concerns that he brought forward, and I hope that I can be a champion for our issues and what we want to accomplish in the next few years at City Hall. So thank you very much for your time.
If I could take a moment of personal privilege outside of my 3 minutes and just say very briefly how honored I am to share a stage with Ms. Sandoval. She is one of my favorite human beings on the planet. And I hope that any District 7 people, please vote for her. I'm a huge fan. My name is Ezra Johnson, and I'm running in District 10. In San Antonio. Just to introduce myself very briefly, I am a husband and a father of two beautiful, talented teenagers. I'm an attorney here in town, and I am also a semi-professional tuba player. Thank you, I appreciate that. One person. Just a little bit more information about me. I'm a fifth generation Texan. I grew up here in San Antonio. I graduated from Edison High School. I got my music degree from UT Austin. I came back to San Antonio and was a music and mathematics instructor in the San Antonio Independent School District for 6 years. Then I went to St. Mary's Law School to get my law degree. I graduated first in my class at St. Mary's University in 2008. I now practice oil and gas law and real estate law. When oil companies break things, and they often break things, and when they spill things, they often spill things, I represent landowners to keep them accountable. The other thing I do is that I'm an adjunct professor of law at St. Mary's University. I teach criminal procedure to the law students, and I teach the American legal system to the master's degree students. What I'm telling people is that I have spent my entire legal career building consensus among people who don't get along very well. And to do the things that I'd like to do on council, which will include being a strong ally for the LGBTQ community, because that affects my family. It affects my family personally. I have family members who are LGBTQ. My oldest daughter is out, and I want to be supportive of her, and I want to be supportive of her life. And so this is a personal issue to me. And so if you come to me with any issue, please know that that will always be right here in my heart. In my heart. So once again,
I ask humbly for your vote if you're in District 10, and my name is Ezra Johnson. Thank you very much.
Let's give them a warm thank you for coming out tonight. So, can I get D1 candidates, please? Michael Montaño, Robert Fettiai is here somewhere. Was Roberto here? Who else is here from D1? So this is the one where we're standing. Those of you who don't know much about city politics, District 1 includes downtown and the neighborhood. And so District 1 is near and dear to all of us. So we expect to hear amazingly wonderful things from, and I think there's one more. Is there one more message? From District 1? Okay, we're good.
He's on his way.
So I didn't say it, but a bunch of people in the room said, too late. But we will put him up on stage when he gets here. So I'd like to go ahead and start the District 1 conversation. Robert Fettiai is a District 1 candidate, and Michael Montaño is also here. You will each have 2 minutes to introduce yourselves. This is an LGBTQ+ group of people, and so we would hope that you would address the concerns of the gay strip, of the neighborhood, and of the LGBTQ community. So, we didn't flip a coin, but one of you would like to volunteer.
Thank you, Lauren. My name is Michael Montaño. I am running for city council here in District 1. I'm very thankful you all came out in the middle of the week when you could be doing any number of fun things besides politics. So I appreciate your civic engagement and commitment to that. I was born and raised here in San Antonio. I grew up on the southwest side, and I had a very, very blessed childhood. My parents believed deeply in education, so they sent me to a small Catholic school that happened to be on the northeast side of town. And what that taught me, and what it demonstrated, was that there are many parts of the city, including many parts of District 1, that are deeply neglected. But neglect isn't just about infrastructure. It's not just about insufficient police funds. It's also about turning a blind eye to some of the real needs of the most marginalized groups in this city. And of course by that, I mean the LGBTQ community here in San Antonio. In San Antonio, about 4% of the population identifies that way. Now when I was in college, everyone always said it was actually closer to the general population. They would say 1 in 4, maybe more. So what that tells me is that we still have a city that is not fully respectful or inviting to people who are not cisgendered straight men. Thank you. So as your councilman, I will fight to make sure that this district remains not just the friendliest district for the LGBTQ community, but also is a guiding light. And it's not enough to be a passenger on the car to freedom, you have to be in the driver's seat. So it's not enough for your councilman to say, we should oppose SB6 because it's bad for business. The logical implication of that is that if it were good for business, it would be A-okay. That is not a moral stance, that is not courage, it is a moral issue, and on council, I will oppose attempts to roll us back to 1950 at every step. I will be your champion, I will be by your side, and I look forward to answering all of your questions as the night goes on. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Robert Fettiai. I'm a labor and community organizer. I currently work with the teachers here in San Antonio. Some of you might remember Harvey Milk, who started off as a community organizer as well, but soon realized he had to get into politics to help defend the system, and defend a system that works for all people, not the status quo. That's why he got involved. Because all people need a voice in our political system, especially the most disenfranchised. Here in San Antonio right now, we are going to be facing greater oppression from the state, greater oppression from our federal government, which makes it even all the more important for us to have a strong city council that has no problem pushing back against people like Dan Patrick and Greg Abbott and Trump. And it's up to all of us to get involved to do that. But we can't do it without having strong elected representatives in city council. It's extremely important because we cannot be marching the streets every day. We're burnt out. It's tough out there. We need someone who's gonna fight for the people of this district. And as Michael said, some of the most disenfranchised among us, you talk about a city the size of San Antonio, the seventh largest in our nation, that doesn't have a Pride Center yet, that has homeless youth out there on the streets every day. And I've talked to people at Thrive Youth Center about what's going on and how the fact that we're not doing enough. When you talk about 85% of people who identify as trans who've been assaulted in their life at some point or another, 50% of those people have been physically assaulted at some point in their life. And at the forum, I think that Colby Balcom said something very important, that this is a gender issue 101, gender 101 issue that we need to be having with each other on education. And as an organizer, as a community organizer, I want to make sure that we are all having this discussion together, that we are all working together to make sure that this district is a progressive district, not a regressive district. And I will fight always for what is ethically and morally right, not what is socially or economically convenient. So thank you very much.
So to ask our first question, is an intern from the Esperanza Peace and Justice Center, who is celebrating their 30th anniversary this year. Monica Landry.
I didn't catch your name, what was it?
Monica.
Monica, thank you so much for that question. Esperanza does great work and I'm glad that you're here tonight. This is a fairly straightforward to me. Let the state pass their discriminatory laws, we will pass our own. And if they want to take us to court, we will do that if that's what it takes. Now, one thing to consider, of course, is I, of course, have my views about how this might work to our benefit. It's important that we, as a community, make sure that we're working together to identify the best path forward. Certainly, that's one path that might be successful. Another is to ensure that we create a small task force, at least within the police department, that will help protect people who are victims of crimes, who are victimized because they are trans. And I think I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much for your question. Thank you for the work that Esperanza Center has done. I would agree. We need, as I said, a strong city council that is going to stand up for what is ethically and morally right to protect human rights for all people and human dignity for all people. So if the state passes SB 6, it's important for us to have a strong city council here who's going to defend people. And we all need to be working together to make sure that each other is protected. We need to be doing education to make sure that other people understand this is a human rights issue. That each person, a person who chooses to identify their gender a certain way, is not doing that to be falsifying, but they're doing that to be true to themselves. They're not trying to, you know, step into a different restroom, some false idea like that. This is something that we have to educate each other on. As far as the police goes, there's been some good work. I think Lauren has done some good work already. But bringing this task force together, so we're educating people not just in law enforcement, but in our schools too, because there are a lot of regressive bills that are also trying to be passed, where education and our teachers would have to inform on our children or not be able to pass their own legislation within their school district to protect the gender identities of their students. So more education is extremely important here.
So now I would like, from PolitiQueers, I would like to introduce Vanessa Sanchez.
My question for y'all is, not only do you support the use of city money to assist in the funding of an LGBT center for SA, but exactly what are your plans to try to improve what we have right now and expand on a future project?
I'm fully in support of using city funds to have a Pride Center here. I've talked about this with people in PolitiQueers before. And since day one, this being the mission to have a physical Pride Center, not just a number that you can call, I think is extremely important for a city this size. And it's embarrassing to have a city this size that doesn't have one already. I think that we can reach out to groups like Thrive, like Fiesta Youth, and I've been in contact with several of these groups already to see that what we can do to put these different resources, these different nonprofits together to do good work in one space, where we can have a one-stop shop, where someone can get the social work help that they need. If they're a teenage runaway that's been forced out of their home, someone there who can counsel them, who can help them get a job, who can help them, if they're trans, help them get gender reassignment or hormone replacement therapy. All of these things need to be considered. HIV testing, STD testing, all of this needs to be something that we need to be putting in a space that is easy for people to get to and easy for just general access to the public.
I think Robert said 95% of what I would have said, so that's, I agree with everything he said. I would only add a couple of things to the prior question about making sure that we're creating safe spaces for trans folks. There are some wonky things we can probably do around building standards to make it easier to create, going forward, European-style bathrooms with common wash basins and floor-to-ceiling, you know, stalls that are simply open to everybody. That's a way to get around some of the contentiousness of that issue while still making it safe for everyone to use, you know, take care of their bodily functions in a way that is comfortable. So everything Robert said, bless that stuff.
So representing the center, Pride Center of San Antonio, with another question, and it seems appropriate. That segue by talking about the Pride Center is Robert Telsio.
Thank you, Lauren. So as we presented to the question to the previous panel that was up here, the top seven cities that San Antonio looks at in terms of comparative cities, when we look at other economic evaluators who were pushing funding and budgets to different topics and different conversations in the city. Of those seven top comparative cities, all of them but one has offered LGBT services and LGBT funding for services that promote within our community not only the diversity of our community. We know Pennsylvania is diverse, but how are we going to promote the inclusivity of our own community? But how are we going to bring that funding to fruition? We have a lot of individuals that are in office right now that have a lot of costs. They will say that yes, we deserve it, yes, we need it, but the fact is that we still don't see it. So as councilmen within District 1, which is the heart of the neighborhood, how would we expect, or how should we move forward and see how you would fund other LGBT community, not only a community center, but also the LGBT organizations that are within our community, because all of our organizations are all volunteer run for the most part.
Let me segue on what Robert said. Since the mayoral candidates, most of them, I think, are also already here. So this is a relatively young crowd. This is not a presidential race. The people in this room have long memories. So we're going to expect what you tell us.
Well, thank you for the question. I think there are probably pockets in the general fund that we could allocate straight up for a center like that. The other thing I would mention is, you know, I was very lucky to go to Central Catholic downtown and then Yale for college and Stanford for law school. And after that, I built a career across multiple sectors. So I've been in nonprofits, I've been in government, and I've been in the business sector. So I bring that up only to say that it's important to think across sectors. And so as council, I think there is a way to use the bully pulpit, the seat, the prominence of the position to go out to foundations, which may be maybe here in the city, or they may be national, and say, hey, let's leverage some funding. Maybe we'll commit, you know, 30% to a center. Maybe we'll get 30% from a foundation. Maybe we'll get 30% from the business that wants to make sure that it knows that its employees are welcome in this city, regardless of who they are or who they love. So thinking through all aspects of the resources that are available and bringing them together to fund that kind of center is something I would work on. So we're not just thinking in terms of only tax dollars, but tax dollars plus plus.
I would agree with Michael in saying that there's definitely a lot in our city budget that we should be reevaluating in the first place. A lot of wasteful pet projects that don't serve the needs of the people here in District 1 or the needs of the people in the city overall, that we could be using to make this a more fair, equitable city for all people. I would also say that what we really need is a plan and the political will to change things. Because we have the numbers. We have people who are willing to do the work. We all are out here because we care. We just need to come up with a strategy and help realize it. That's what organizing is about, that's what building our community is about, in order to make real change here. We can push for a Pride Center. This is a discussion that we've been having more and more recently. That's why so many people are out here tonight, to have a real discussion about the LGBTQ community and what we need to do in this city to protect ourselves and to make sure that we're not being marginalized anymore. So I would say it starts with us. It starts with us standing up and saying, what can I do? What can I do? How can I talk to my neighbor? How can I talk to another person in my community? How can I make them understand the struggle that I'm in? And I think that's how we're really going to accomplish what we need to accomplish here for District 1, the neighborhood, and to build a real Pride Center and help out all our allies in the LGBTQ community.
Thank you. So, we're going to be taking about 10 more minutes, but rather than using more organizations, I would like to open the floor. If anyone has especially follow-up questions or just a pressing question that they just can't stand not to answer.
Issues like extreme violence, police brutality and suicide as the rights, the trans community's rights and liberties are also often left out when we promote LGBT rights and protection. And also, I'd like to point out, it's especially important because, as you said before, a trans person, there's nothing wrong with them choosing to be another gender, but like I would like to address, they do not choose to be a gender other than the one they're assigned at birth. So I think constant education is important, and I want to know how each of you will go about that. Thank you.
I thank you for that question because I think you're absolutely right. Trans people really are at the center of a struggle that a lot of people don't know about, and it's life or death for them. You've had 7 trans people murdered in 2017 already, 26 or 27 last year in 2016. Half of the homeless youth out there identify as trans. Most of them and this is information I get from talking to people at Thrive Youth Center who work with homeless trans youth. Most of them are being kicked out of their homes. And Thrive Youth, for example, is the only trans youth homeless advocacy center in the South. So there are not many in the whole country, and this is the only one we have in the entire southeastern region here. So it's a very serious issue. And when you think about all of the things that a trans person has to deal with, hearing stories about people who they want to go get a job, they're going to go get a job, everything looks great, and then all of a sudden they look and say, oh, we just need your driver's license, and here in Texas, because your drivers, they go by the gender and the sex you were assigned, you were given at birth, all of a sudden makes it that much harder to get a job. You're not able to use the restroom because you're holding in all day, because you're afraid someone might say something or attack you, or you might lose your job. All of a sudden, you have health problems because of that. And this is a serious issue. In our schools too, I mean, it starts young. We would not tolerate racism in our schools from an early age. We would do something about it. Why are we doing something about educating people about gender identity? I think we have to be doing that early on. We have to be partnering with our school districts here. We have to be pushing groups to be more proactive in this. There are groups out there that are very proactive on immigration reform, making sure that undocumented peoples are being protected. Let's make sure that our teachers and our educators are also being proactive on educating people about gender identity. And not just that, okay, you can go use the nurse's restroom, but you can use the restroom of the gender that you feel is your own. So more education, standing up and protecting people. Thank you.
So I think in part your question was about how we would educate ourselves, right? And I think that's a really important point to make. I don't have all the answers. I won't ever have all the answers. And I have no vested interest in my ideas being the best ideas. What I care about is the outcome. Right, so if something I suggest doesn't turn out to work well, all I'm suggesting is an experiment, and we'll see if it works, and we'll try the next thing until we get it right. More specifically, I think it's important for any council member to spend time meeting not only with the leaders of some of the groups that we know work closely with the LGBTQ community, but also with the rank and file folks who get assistance from them. So they can see up and down what the problems are. They're not getting a particular perspective. They're really seeing it from 360 degrees. So that's something that's important to me. And that goes not just to organizational level, but also age. And I think Robert made a good point about thinking about how we do things in the schools as a starting place. The other is, and I hate the term sensitivity training, because it all sounds like you're saying, oh, like if people are too sensitive, we need to accommodate them somehow in an unreasonable way. But whatever the better way of saying sensitivity training is, it'd be a good idea if we did that, especially around the transgender issue, for police and fire especially, but also all city employees. Right? I mean, let's start the city council folks with where we can, where we know we can have an impact immediately, and that's with policies that affect our own employees and those who work for the fire and safety departments. So those are some of my thoughts, and I encourage you, I'll be around, so if you have other things that you want to tell me about it, let me know.